Many of the ancient Indo-European traditions, celebrations and rituals that connected our ancestors together have for a long time been hidden away from us, like an old forest full of trees with intertwined roots beneath the surface. We are often of the belief that the knowledge is lost. However, this is not necessarily the case. Many of the old ways are simply hidden in a network of puzzles, poems, and misconceptions. It is like a blurred image. We can see something, but we are not quite sure what we can see. Where does Yule originate from? And is Yule held on winter solstice? I asked myself these questions before I began my journey down through the rabbit hole, a hole that would lead me through a network of rabbit holes, and this video is the result of it. Is it true what you have heard? Does Christmas really have pagan roots? I have come across many theories of why we celebrate Yule, and these theories often seem to have an exaggerated interpretation of our past. Of course, we will never know every single little detail, since most of it was never written down. But we can look at the sources that we have available and try to get as close to understand the origin of the Yule celebration and when Yule was celebrated. There's this widespread belief that the pagan Yule celebration is about the return of the sun. Every year, it's the same thing. New articles pop up on the web, recycled from last year, after going through a 5-minute trip into the word blender. One article after another state the fact that Yule is on winter solstice and that this day is about celebrating the return of the sun. Before we can understand what Yule is about, we need to look at the meaning of the word. Yule, or Yule, as we call it in Scandinavia, is a word that has been passed down from generation to generation for thousands of years. The word Yule is actually plural and it literally means parties. The word is therefore not referring to one single party or one event, but to several Yule celebrations that most likely took place between the winter solstice and the Yule sacrifice. The word Yule originates from Old Norse. However, the celebration is much older than the word itself. The actual meaning of the word seems to have been lost with time. Some people believe that the word is connected to the word Yule. It sounds similar, but it means wheel in Scandinavia. The word wheel could in this case then refer to the sun cross, also called the sun wheel, or in Danish, soljule. There are three main theories about Yule. The first theory describes it as a celebration for the return of the sun. The second theory talks about Yule as a midwinter party for the dead. The third theory describes Yule as a fertility feast, where people would sacrifice animals to the gods in the hopes of getting a good harvest for the coming year. Since Yule is about several parties and not just one, all three theories could, in theory, be true. Yule is not, as many people might think, just a Scandinavian celebration. It is, in fact, in its origin, Germanic. The pagan gods and goddesses are often associated with the Vikings and Scandinavia today, but it has a broader origin. Tribes in northern Germany and northern Poland did also consist of people who followed the Nordic gods. The Slavic people to the east also have their own version of a winter festival called Kolida. This celebration is just as ancient as Yule, and it is possible that they have a connection with each other in one way or another. It is not something that I will elaborate more about in this video. The winter traditions spread across the continent of Europe when people traveled either for trading, raiding, or exploring The two tribes, Angles and Saxons, also brought these traditions with them when they migrated to the British Isles. It is not totally ridiculous to think that Yule is held at winter solstice to celebrate the return of the sun. After all, it is the shortest day of the year in the Northern Hemisphere, and having a festival to celebrate the return of the sun would make perfect sense. However, while the sun was very important to the people of the North, they were not obsessed with the sun as some Mayan shaman, cutting out hearts and offering them to their sun god. I believe if the sun had a more central role, like it did with the Mayans, it would have been much more reflected in the sagas. The sun and the moon are also not deities in the Norse religion, but rather personified beings. The sun is female, and the moon is male. They are servants of the gods, and most likely tools that were used to count time. The Nordic people were probably seeing the sun and the moon as cosmic theaters, rather than a deity or an object that was to be worshipped. The name of the moon in Old Norse also seemed to confirm this, a name that literally means he who counts the year or teller of time, according to the elves. Thor said, "Tell me, Alvis, by the fate of all families. I deem that a dwarf will know, but the moon is called as men see in all worlds so wide." Alvis said, "It is called moon among men, mild light among gods, and hell, the spinning wheel, quick among the Jotnar, skin among dwarves, teller of time among elves." Before I dig further into the meat of this video about Yule, it is important to understand where the sources are from. The people who lived in Scandinavia prior to the Christification did not write their traditions down on paper, but instead their religion, stories and traditions were passed down orally from their parents to their children. There are many sources available today that describes the Scandinavian society during and prior to the Viking Age. However, most of these are observations that were made by foreign people or people who lived in Scandinavia after the Christification. This is an important detail to be aware of. Just imagine if everything we knew about the natives of America was only written down by the settlers hundreds of years later. One source that has described the society within Scandinavia in the Viking Age was the Icelandic author Snorri Sturluson. He was an author that has become very famous for writing down the stories and traditions from the people of Scandinavia. However, many of these stories were written down almost 200 years after the Viking Age ended. Nevertheless, Snorri Sturluson is still a great source, and we have come to understand a great deal from his books from this period in time. However, he was not a pagan, but he was a Christian, and his books have therefore been written down from a Christian perspective. And this is just also something to keep in mind when reading them. Another element that adds to the difficulty to interpret the old text is that Snorri often wrote them in a poetic style. While this makes the story more entertaining for the reader, it also makes it more difficult to interpret. Some of the details that would have been commonly understood in the society and was part of their everyday life might not be something that we have the same understanding of today, and we could misunderstand parts of the text. For instance, technology and norms change constantly in our modern society. Just ask your child if they know what a tape salad is. We can't just push the sun theory completely away. The sun was still very important to the people of the North. The return of the sun was a turning point after a long and dark winter, and it could have been an important date for the people. Since most people were farmers, it was important to know the path of the sun, especially when you live in a harsh environment. The people needed to know when to sow and reap. Scandinavia is not like a continent such as Africa, where you can pick berries from the trees all year round and hang out on the beach. They needed to prepare for the long winters. The people of the north are the people of ice and fire. Living there means to prepare, innovate and adapt. And the sun was definitely a part of that. The amount of sun crosses or sun wheels found at archaeological excavations in Scandinavia also adds to the fact that the sun was significant. There's no exact date for when Yule was held for the first time, but archaeological evidence seems to indicate that the worship of the sun goes back at least 7,000 years. The sun cross can often be seen carved onto many of the runestones throughout Scandinavia. However, the sun cross is not just found on runestones. This one-of-a-kind sun chariot was found in 1902 at Trundholm Mose in Denmark, and it has been dated to 1350 BCE, more than 2000 years before the Viking Age even began. This might sound like a very long time ago, but we can go even further back. The oldest sun wheel or sun cross that's been found in Europe dates back to 5000 BCE. It was made from oak tree and it was found at Pilkmosen in Give, Denmark. We are actually quite lucky because there's actually one source that describes this pagan winter solstice ritual before Christianity got their grips on the Scandinavians. The ritual was observed in the 6th century by the Byzantine chronicler Procopius, who visited the island of Thule. However, it should be said that it is not possible to point at a place on a map and say, that was the island. The word Thule is not really a place, it is more of a term. Thule or Ultima Thule means a distant place located beyond the borders of the known world. The north was the borders of the known world, at least to him. The scholars today do seem to agree on the fact that this place was probably located somewhere in Scandinavia, possibly in northern Norway. Around the time of the winter solstice, the sun is never to be seen on this island for 40 days, but the internal night encloses it. And when 35 days have passed in this long night, certain men are sent up to the top of the mountains, because that is their custom. When those men barely can see the sun from that point, they return to the village with the message that within 5 days the sun will shine on them again. The people would then celebrate a party about 20 days after the winter solstice, and this would be the biggest party held by the natives at Thule. The German bishop Tietmar of Merseburg wrote in the 11th century that the biggest Yule feast was held in January in the village of Lejre in Denmark, and not on the winter solstice. However, no exact date was mentioned. The date of the big Yule feast celebration always seemed to vary in the old text, and the question is, why is this day bouncing back and forth, and why is it not just celebrated on a certain day? Well, it is and it isn't. The Norse used a lunar calendar to count time, but there is a very big problem with using the moon to calculate time, because it only takes 354 days to complete 12 lunar cycles, which are 11 days short of the 365 days that it takes the Earth to orbit the Sun. This means that the new moon this year will occur 11 days earlier than it did last year. And every year, it will move the new moon another 11 days backward than it was the previous year. And it will keep doing that unless there's some sort of system that prevents it. A lunar calendar simply won't stay still. The lunar calendar needs an exception, something that can be observed in the northern hemisphere, and something that is always the same. What could be better than winter solstice, which is the shortest day of the year and always falls on either the 21st or 22nd of December? A fixed date for joining the lunar year and the solar year into a lunar solar calendar. According to the researcher Andreas Norberg, to make up for the 11 days that were lost with the lunar calendar, the Nordic people may have used a leap year every third year by inserting a 13th month around the time of the summer solstice. The 13th month would be added if the new moon of the second Yule month emerged 11 days or less after the winter solstice. This would have been done to prevent the second Yule month in the following year to start before the winter solstice. In that way, winter solstice would always be in the first Yule month, and the Yule sacrifice would always be celebrated on the first full moon following the new moon past winter solstice. If this was indeed the method that the pagans used is uncertain, but it could explain why the time of the celebration would vary so much in these sources. In practice, this means that the first new moon after the winter solstice marked the beginning of the second Yule month, which means that the second Yule month began with the new moon that occurs between the 22nd of December and the 19th of January. This is the month where the Yule celebrations, according to this theory, takes place. Yule sacrifice is celebrated on the first full moon, following the first new moon past winter solstice. The full moon will occur on the 5th of January at the earliest and on the 2nd on February at the latest. The whole Yule month is therefore celebrated from winter solstice until the first full moon following the first new moon. One of the oldest sources that mentions the word Yule is in a poem by the poet Torbjørn. The poem was written in the 10th century to the king of Norway, Harald Fairhair. On one of its pages it is written that the Norwegian king wants to drink Yule. He wants to drink Yule out at sea. If he alone should rule, the brave king, and practice the sport of Frey. It might not be quite obvious what this poem is trying to tell us, but it praises him for being brave, because he would rather drink and fight with his enemies at sea than to sit at home with a horn of meat in his hand. This poem also tells us that drinking was a big part of Yule, and a drinking tradition that is not really practiced anymore. At least not this extreme. However, drinking is still a big part of the Scandinavian culture, especially here in Denmark, where we have a very high alcohol consumption, and where the sound of drink, drink, drink often can be heard as echoes throughout the night. Since the word Yule is plural, it is possible that multiple ritual feasts were held during the Yule month. One party could have been a fertility celebration in honor of the god Frey, and another in the honor of the god Odin. Some parties could have been held with the family and their friends, and others by the entire village. A good Yule is not without a sacrifice, or is it? There are many rumors floating around that claims that the pagans made offerings during their Yule celebrations. Some believe that animals were sacrificed, others are convinced that it was humans. Let's unwrap another Yule myth and see what the sources tell us. In an old poem from the Viking Age, it is written, "I think that the king Harald Fairhair was preparing for Yule for Hugging's herd." Herd means family, and it comes from the Proto-Germanic word, which I'm not gonna try to pronounce, but you can see it on screen. As you probably can see, this is written in a poetic style, but its context matters, at least if we want to understand its meaning. Harald Fairhair had, prior to the celebration of Yule, defeated an enemy in battle, and now the bodies from all the slain laid on the battlefield as a feast for the raven, Hugin's family, all the ravens. Ravens are important animals in the Norse religion. For instance, Hugin and Munin are the two ravens that belong to the god Odin, who is known under many names, including the raven god. A feast for the ravens could be considered an offering to the pagan god Odin, who is also the god of war. According to Tietmeyer, the sacrifice was a big part of Yule, and this is something that he mentioned in his chronicle. Every ninth year, there were a big Yule celebration in the village of Lejre. At this Yule sacrifice, 99 humans, including and just as many roosters, dogs and horses, were sacrificed to the pagan gods. These numbers do seem a bit exaggerated, to be honest, and there are no other sources about this event that can either confirm or deny it. However, Lejre is a village that has been mentioned many times in the past, for instance, in the famous saga of Beowulf. The village Lejre is not just any village, it is from this village that the legendary royal family called Skjoldungerne originates from. Skjoldungerne means the shell kids. This family was known for their enormous amount of wealth. However, today this family seems to be most known for one thing, at least in the media, which is Ragnar Lothbrok, who was one of these Skjoldunger. Yes, he was Danish. In 1075, the German medieval chronicler Adam of Bremen wrote about a Yule ritual that took place in the Viking Age in the village called Uppsala in Sweden. We do not know the exact location, but it is probably the great pagan hall that used to be in the old part of Uppsala. If plague and famine threatens, a libation is poured to the idol of Thor. If war, to Odin. If marriages are to be celebrated, to Frey. In 965, the Arab merchant called Al-Tartushi visited Hedeby in southern Denmark. This was an important trade town in northern Europe, at least at this time, and he probably had some goods to trade. While he was in Hedeby, he witnesses one of these blots. If it was during Yule, it's uncertain, but this is what he wrote. "They celebrate a festival at which all come to worship the god and to eat and drink. The one who slaughters a sacrificial animal erects stakes at the entrance to his farmyard and puts the sacrificial animal on them. This is so the people know that he is sacrificing in honor of his god. Drinking large amount of alcohol and eating meat from animal sacrifices does seem to have been the main part of a successful Yule celebration. At least it was so when the society was mainly pagans. Some of the evidence for this is mentioned in the saga of Håkon the Good by the Icelandic author Snorri Sturluson. The king of Norway was expected to participate in the annual Yule sacrifice with the farmers. This was not something that the king was particularly fond about because of his Christian faith. However, he did decide to travel to Trøndelagen in Norway and participate in the event. Before the Yule sacrifice began, all kinds of animals were sacrificed, especially horses. The blood from the dead animals was collected in bowls and then sprinkled, most likely by a vulvar, someone who practiced shamanism or witchcrafts, most often a female, on the altars, walls and the participants by using sacrificial tricks. The meat was then cooked in kettles that hang over a fire on the floor in the middle of the big hall. The farmers told the king to make sacrifices to the gods, and if he refused it, it would most likely cost him dearly. The pagans wanted him to drink meat and eat the horse liver. However, the king seems to have gotten off the hook when the jarl Sigurd intervened, and the king got away by just smelling some of the horse liver. The farmers teased the king and kept serving him meat, but without making the cross sign over them, which is or was a Christian custom. Cups was raised in the honor of the gods, first Odin, Skjold, and then to the victorious king. A new cup was filled, Skjold to Enyo and Frey for good years and peace. Then many of the participants at the blood emptied the cup and made personal promises of great accomplishments. Finally, the cups were raised in the honor of the ancestors who rested in the mounds. While many of us might think that the New Year's resolution is a modern tradition, where we make promises to ourselves under the influence of alcohol, it is actually not. The annual tradition of making New Year's resolutions dates back more than 4,000 years to the Babylonian civilization. Every year on the 1st of March, the Babylonians celebrated the spring festival called Akito. The Babylonians would swear oaths to the gods and try and keep them to stay on the good side. The Scandinavians did also have an annual tradition of swearing oaths to their gods, the Yule Oath. However, if you do not keep your oath, it would have serious consequences. An oath to the gods was not something that was taken lightly, and you could end up with paying the ultimate price if you broke it. The Yule Oath is an oath that is made during Yuletide, for instance at the Yule sacrifice. You can swear an oath for anything you want, however other pagans could punish you by law if you broke the oath. What is a successful Yule celebration without Yule presents? How common it was to gift Yule presents to each other in the past, for instance in the Viking Age, is not something we can know for certain. However, there are examples that the jarls and successful merchants gave presents in the Yule month to their friends, family, and other people that were important to them. Carls and Jarls may also have been giving Yule presents to their king or queen. The Jarl Sigurd that I mentioned earlier at the plot was remembered by everyone at the Yule feast for his generosity, because he gave presents to everyone at the feast. The famous Icelandic author Snorri Sturluson mentions in his saga about the Norwegian king Håkon the Good that the king had decided that the Yule celebration should be moved and placed on the 25th of December, when the Christians celebrate Christmas. The king, who was a Christian, probably wanted to use his influence to replace the pagan Yule celebration with Christmas, and moving the date could have been the first step. This was clearly an unpopular action, but it was the king's attempt to Christianize Norway. However, it was not everyone that was easily persuaded to let go of the pagan ways, and King Håkon had to be careful, since he still needed the support of the people to keep him in power. The Norwegian king, Olaf Tryggvason, was also not pleased with the pagan bloods, and he actually forbid the practice of bloods and their drinking feasts, but he did allow the Christian drinking feasts at Christian holidays. When Scandinavia changed from being small clans of pagans to mostly Christians, the old name Yule remained. There are no sources that explain why the old name for Yule was kept as the name for Christmas in Scandinavia. It could have been because it was easier to convince the pagans to become Christians, since the winter celebrations with plenty of food and meat continued. If the annual Yule festival would have changed its original name to Christmas, it would probably have been called Kristmesse in Danish, which is the literal translation of Christmas into Danish. However, because of nostalgia or tradition, the name Yule, or in Danish Jul, will probably remain indefinitely. Some of the old traditions from how the pagans celebrated Yule can still be found at the tables in Scandinavia, which is held on the 24th of December. If we look at the food, in Denmark about 50% eat duck and pork. Pagans did not eat duck, at least not at this celebration, but they definitely ate pork at Yule. And that is not an assumption or an educated guess, we actually know this. Archaeological excavations from an old Yule feast in Denmark has shown us that. We do not know how exactly the pagans cooked the pork, but in most of the Danish homes today, the pork is roasted. We call it flæskesteg in Danish. The consumption of alcohol and singing is still a big part of the Yule celebration. However, instead of raising our cups in honor of Odin and Frey, our cups are mostly raised to wish each other at the table a Merry Christmas, or as we say in Scandinavia, Glædelig Jul, or God Jul.